Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at Christ in the book of Ephesians. Christ in the book of Ephesians. The book of Ephesians is a very spiritual, all the books of the Bible are spiritual, but the church, the Christians and the saints of God and the church in Ephesus were very, very spiritual in the sense that God and Paul has spent 2 years teaching them daily. We see an account of this in the Acts of the Apostles, the school of Tyrannus, and he had grounded them very well in the word of God and the scriptures daily for 2 years. He was teaching them. And so here was an epistle that the apostle wrote to them, the Holy Spirit writing to them. And someone might ask, what's the big picture of the book of Ephesians? We are not doing a summary of Ephesians. We are looking at Christ in the book of Ephesians. But basically, Ephesians is about the church, about the body of Christ. Colossians and Ephesians are like twin books. Colossians talks about the head of the church, and Ephesians is talking about the body. That is the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, the church of the living God. The church has the body of Christ. The church has the kingdom of God. The church has the wife of the Lord Jesus Christ. The church has the warrior of the Lord Jesus Christ. The church has the family of God. But we won't go into that. We've done a different teaching on that, on Christ and the summary of the book of Ephesians. Today is looking at the wonderful Savior we have on the person of our Lord Jesus Christ, his title, his works, what he has done in the past, what he is doing today, and what he will continue to do in our life. That's the line we're going through in this. So first of all, we look at him in the sense that the one we are in union with, and it's a marvel. The book started with Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints which are in Ephesus, and to the faithful who are in union with Christ. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So the book started with the introduction, the salutation, that we are the Christians, the saints of God in Ephesus, that we are in union with Christ, and that is an organic union. And more of the details of this we'll see. Actually, that's the central theme of the, if I say, the New Testament, and even in the book of Ephesians, the union of Christ and the believers is also the grace of God, is the peace of God. There is no grace outside of Christ. There is no peace any man enjoys outside of Christ. Going ahead, I think verse 3 talks about, blessed be God who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in Christ Jesus, in union with Christ in heavenly. That means God has blessed us with every blessing we could ever imagine, the saints of God, in union with Christ. So we dare not touch any blessing of God outside of our union with Christ. And here was a very profound scripture, I would say, that God has blessed us with every blessing under heaven. That is the potential. God has made it a reality in our life. It's a different thing whether we are manifesting or whether our life is showing forth those blessings. Of course, there are a lot of other things that from what God has said and for what is happening, of course, we have to grow up spiritually. God will hardly just take any one of us a saint and just get us to the next dimension of his blessings, of his glory, without the spiritual stamina, without the inner man being strengthened, so that as we are growing spiritually, a lot of these blessings will be manifesting in our life. So looking ahead, still on chapter 1, so before the foundation of the world, God chose us to be his through our union with Christ. And one of the great things about Ephesians, especially from chapter 1, it tells us what happened in eternity past. So some of the things that from verse 4 in chapter 1, you see the work that the Lord did in eternity past. Eternity past is before Genesis chapter 1 verse 1. This was before the heavens and the earth were created. So here is the Holy Spirit giving us that picture, that before the foundation of the world, God chose us to be his, that is to be God's, through our union with Christ. So God had this plan, eternity past, that he was going to create man, and out of the created man, a new man was going to fall. That's why the lamb was slain before the foundation of the world. And he knew that after man fell, that he was going to come out with a redemptive plan, and this redemptive plan will involve him, God in Christ, God manifest in the flesh, God the Son, coming to die for man. And after death, he now resurrects to now bring us in union with the person of our Lord Jesus Christ. So God had this plan very hard. So Ephesians is telling us what happened before the world was created. God has made us holy and blameless before him. That is, in the eyes of God, God decided that we were going to be holy and blameless before him in love. in union with Christ. So any God looks at us, his saints and his believers, and what he's seeing is Christ. That's why the script, you see that phrase all through the Bible in the New Testament, in Christ, in him, in whom, by whom, because God is dealing with us, believers in Christ Jesus, through the lens of Christ. So our blamelessness and holiness before God, let's not forget, thank God for the fact we definitely, God is not just making us blameless positionally, but is also working the things that is what it's normally, it's usually called the dispositional sanctification. So we are blameless before God, yet God is still working in us that which is well pleasing in his sight. So through our union with Christ, it is through union with Christ we are blameless before the Lord. It is through union with Christ that is the zenith of our holiness before God as well. What a joy what God has done. So in eternity past, God decided and predestined to make us his sons and daughters through Jesus Christ. This was his pleasure and purpose. God delighted in this. This was his goal in eternity past, that he will make us his sons and his daughters, his children, in union with Christ. And everything that God was going to do, I think in this chapter 1 of Ephesians, it's probably almost 20 or 22 times the name God was mentioned. That is like God was working. God is working. That God had all this planned out, that we were going to be his children, but we were going to be his children through union with Christ. So it is only through union with Christ any man can, or any woman can, say that they are child of God. And what a joy that this was God's pleasure and purpose. So let us praise God for his glorious grace. One of the great things about this teaching of Christ in different books of the Bible, I believe strongly that is the Bible is just an autobiography of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the word of God. Is the center theme, is the subject of the whole Bible from Genesis to Revelation. So we come into here, and in verse 1, God is telling us that let us praise God for his glorious grace which he has given to us. That is like the books of the Bible were given to us. I believe, in my own opinion, one of the top priorities, that so that we see what the Lord has done for us, we see what he's doing. We can't help but praise is just flowing from our heart of what God has done. Let us praise God for his glorious grace, for the free gift he gave us in his dear son. What a joy, what a joy for this free gift he gave us. For by the blood of Christ, still on chapter 1, we are set free. That is, our sins are forgiven. By the blood of Christ, we are set free and our sins are forgiven. It is through his blood that we experience the forgiveness of sin. Still on chapter 1, the grace God has given to us in such large measure. Of course, it is the grace of God, grace and truth. The law was given by Moses, and grace and truth came by Jesus Christ, John chapter 1. And so God has given us this grace in such a large measure. Still on chapter 1, God's plan is to bring everything in heaven and on earth under the headship of Christ. So the goal of God is to bring everything under the headship of Christ. Right now, we can't technically say that everything is under the headship of Christ. And when we mean headship, we're talking about the whole element of creation. Of course, that's why we have the animals are still behaving wonderfully, whichever way they were created to be. Of course, there's these powers of darkness. There are a lot of unfair injustice all around the world, but of course the headship has to start from somewhere. So that's why we only get to chapter 5, we see that Christ is the head of the church. So the headship of Christ starts with the church, in my own opinion. So the church is the center point. In his second coming, in the millennium, the 1000 millennium rule, he will come back physically and everything will be under his headship. He is ruler over the kings of the earth. He is the head of all principality and power. But going by what is the account of this in Ephesians 1, that God's plan is to bring everything, because you might say that there are two big rebellions in the history of, I want to say, humanity, or maybe in the history of creation. The first big rebellion is Lucifer, the angelic rebellion, the fallen angels, Lucifer, the rebellion in the heavens, of course, when they were cast down. And the second rebellion was what Adam did in the Garden of Eden. And with these two rebellions, everything was not under the headship of God, under the headship of the Trinity of Christ. But God's intention is to bring everything back. Of course, it starts with us in the church, but this is a very big area. We did a teaching on that, on the headship of Christ. We talked more about those two big rebellions and how Christ, God has put him as head over all things. So looking at still in chapter 1, in him we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, What a joy for us as saints of God, as believers, that God has given us an inheritance. So for the Israelites and in the Old Testament, their inheritance was the promised land, the good land. For us in the New Testament, our inheritance is just the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's our allotted portion. So God is saying, in Him we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of Him, who works all things according to the counsel of His will. What a joy that for us as believers, all things definitely will work together for our good. That is, we are praising God, we are thanking Him, we are studying the Word, we are praying to Him, that in any situation we are in, God says He can cause every one of them to work according to the counsel of His will. Also, the one we are to trust in to the praise of God is the one that we are to trust in to the praise of the Almighty God. God chose us to be His own people in union with Christ because of His own purpose. So God had a purpose. So look at it this way: for your life, for my life, for every life of every believer, I believe for every man that God has ever, any human being, God's intention, God has a purpose for everyone's life. Some of them have not known Him as their Lord and Savior, and of course they can't live to the full reality of God's intention for their life. But for us as saints of God, there's something God wants to do, a solution, that we are an answer to the world in a way, in certain areas of life. So God's purpose is that He has a purpose for our life, and it takes only God to work what He had preordained before the foundation of the world. And God will always walk through Christ. God will only walk in union with Christ. So God is dealing with you and I because we are in union with Christ. So He's going to carry out His purpose in our life because we are in union with Christ. This is why we celebrate our union with Christ, because everything in the Christendom, just take the union with Christ away from Christendom, and Christianity will just be like another dead religion, Buddhist, Muslim, because what gives us faith is that He is the author and the finisher of our faith. It is Him that makes us Christian. That's actually where we got the name from. Through union with Him, God has placed His seal, stamp of ownership, the Holy Spirit on us. So you, like we mentioned earlier, that everything God will do in this new creation is through Christ, is the mystery of God. So the stamp, which is the stamp of ownership, the seal of God. So every one of us as believers in Christ Jesus, we have a seal of God upon our life. It's an invisible seal. The carnal eyes cannot see it. And that seal is the person of the Holy Spirit. So this is more like a down payment God made. We are still going to experience the full measure of it in eternity future. But God has put the seal of His Son over us in the person of the Holy Spirit over our life. And what a joy for what the Lord has done. Looking ahead is the one our faith should be in. Our faith should not be in any other thing. Yes, we should do everything. They said the scripture said the horse is prepared for battle, but victory belongs to the Lord. And everything we are doing, we put diligence to what we are doing, and all that we find our hands find to do, we do it with all our might. But our faith should rest on the fact that it is in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Also, is the one that opens the eyes for understanding, so that we can know the hope of His calling for our life. There's no way we can know God's purpose for our life, especially in this world where we are living at now. It's very tempting to do what others are doing. It's very tempting to see what your fellow brother or sister, what business, what career, what striving, what industry should want to delve into that will probably bring more economic gains. But we should not be tempted with going along that path. Yes, we could pay attention to it, but much more we pay attention that God, Lord, open my eyes of understanding. And I love that prayer in Ephesians 1, that He will give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of our understanding being enlightened. That is, our eyes being enlightened, not just physical, the spiritual eyes, so that we will know the hope of His calling for our life. There's no point in just doing what seems economically beneficial if that's not what God has ordained for me to do here on earth. So He still is the very person, the Spirit of Christ, that opens our eyes to that. The God we raised up, and the one God raised up from the dead and seated Him in the heavenly. So Ephesians 1 still tells us that He's the one that God raised up from the dead and seated Him in the heavenlies and made Him far above. He now rules over all principality and power and might and dominion and every name, not only in this age but in that which is to come. So He's ruling over every sphere of human endeavor, and we, the church, we are the fullness of Him who fills all in all. So this is where God has exalted Him to. Of course, when we get to chapter 4, we see more of that. God has put all things under His feet and gave Him to be the head over all things, to the church. So He has supreme headship over everything under heaven and in heaven. Everything is under his headship. God has made him head over all things. And the joy that we are now getting is that because as believers in Christ Jesus, we are the ones that actually have the true power. Any power my head has is going to be executed through my body, just like you as well. The head is the position of authority. It is the hands and the legs that gets the job done. So what a joy that this is part of the things that actually boost our prayer life, that we know that we are not just praying. We don't just have a Lord who is like more or less there's an authority, that there are certain elements or forces that he's subject to. But this is a Lord that has been made head over all, so that when we are praying with boldness, we are declaring the word of God with every form of authority. The church is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. So chapter 1 pretty much summarizes it, that the church is the body of Christ. Just as you have your hands, your legs, every mortal human being, that the church is the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord is the head. We are the body. There's an organic union between the head and the body. So let's go to chapter 2. And it's very tempting to try to stay in one point, but because it's quite a few of them, there are a lot of them, so we probably might not dwell in anyone specifically. So chapter 2, the one through whom God has made us alive, quickened from the dead. It is through him that God has made us alive. That is, being made alive is like we were dead in Adam. Our spirit man was dead in Adam. God has now quickened us from the dead and raised us up together with Christ Jesus. Still on chapter 2 as well. But God, who is rich in mercy and his love for us is so great, that while we were spiritually dead, he brought us to life with Christ. So take, for example, let's do some comparison. The book of Romans summarizes that God has made sinners his sons through faith in Christ Jesus, for the building of the body of Christ. Ephesians is coming from the angle that we were not just sinners, that we were dead, and God has now quickened us. So you look at those two books, that Romans is telling us our history, that we were sinners. Ephesians is saying, forget about being sinners, you were actually dead. God brought you back to life. So in this chapter 2, that God in his rich mercy for and his love for us is so good, that while we were spiritually dead, he brought us to life in Christ Jesus, which is the regeneration of our spirit man. God raised us up together. So he didn't just raise us up from the dead. If he had done that, that's more than sufficient. I don't want the joy. We are dead. We are bad. But no, God said, no, I didn't bring you from the dead to just be alive. I'm also going to make you to sit together with my son in heavenly places. What a joy. Why would we be full of thanksgiving? Why would adoration to the Father, the Son, and the Spirit not fill our heart? That God has raised us up with him and has seated us with him to rule with him in the heavenlies. Wow, what a joy. What an authority. That's why he said he's giving us power, that all power and authority has been given to him, and he dedicated it to us, his believers in Christ Jesus, that whatever we ask in his name. Oh, what a joy. We pray that we will not be spiritually lazy. God did this to demonstrate for all time to come the extraordinary greatness of his grace in the love he showed to us in Christ Jesus. So everything we're going to be seeing, especially in this book of Ephesians, is like everything God is doing is going to put that phrase there, in Christ Jesus. It's because it's in union with Christ. If you are not in union with Christ, forget about this. So God demonstrated this for all time, the extraordinary greatness of his grace in the love that he showed us in union with Christ. Still on chapter 2 as well, God has made us what we are, and in our union with Christ, he has recreated us for good works, which he foreordained for us to do. That is, he recreated us. Initially, we were created in Adam, the first Adam. Now we've been recreated in the second man, the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So God is now saying that we were not just recreated for us to go and live our own ideas, our agendas, and what have you. God's intention is like he wants to carry out his good works, which he foreordained, that is, which he predestined in eternity past. So for you, for me, I don't think God put the responsibility on us for us to kind of come up with something we need to do to be successful, to be a light in the world. It has been foreordained, it has been predestined in the place of prayer, Jeremiah 33:3, also Jeremiah 29, I think 12:13 as well, that we call on the Lord, and as we call on him, he will show us great and mighty things which we don't know. And the goal is for us so that we can carry out the good works. So let your light so shine before men, they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. So what a joy that we've been recreated unto good works in union with Christ. So he's the one that we were once without, hence strangers from the covenant of promise. So here is Ephesians also telling us our history before we got saved. Sometimes it's, you really don't know the value of maybe water in your house until, for one reason or the other, maybe there's a problem with the water supply from the city, and then the water was cut off for the whole neighborhood. And all of a sudden, you find out that, wow, to cook, there's a problem there. You want to drink water, there's an issue. You want to wash the dishes, and all of a sudden, you find out that, wow, this is the power of water. Or even if it's light, if the electric power went out. So now you can see it from this angle of what the Holy Spirit is doing in this book. Now look at where you were before you gave your life to Christ. So when we were once that, the one we were once without, we were without Christ. We were not in union with Christ before salvation came our way. And then we were strangers from the covenant of promise. He kept going further. In union with him, we are no longer without hope and without God on the world. So when we were Gentiles, when we were without Christ, we were without hope. We are without God. So we are just a sitting duck for the enemy, for the devil to do whatever he wants to do. We are actually subjects of him. We are his children as Gentiles. So now God, we are no longer without hope. We are no longer without God. But we have God in this world because we are in union with Christ. What a joy, what a joy. Money cannot buy this. Nothing under heaven. No other possession or asset will any man have in life that we ever come near having God under heaven. What a joy that what the Lord has done. But now in union with him, we have been brought near to God by his blood. So here again in chapter 2, it's like we're being made to know that we were brought near to God. We were actually brought to the very presence of God. And actually, it's not just to the very presence of God. We were brought into God, and God was also brought into us. So we are living in God, and God is living in us. 1 John 4:15, I think, said that whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwells in him. He dwells in God, and God dwells in him. What a joy, what a joy, what a joy that we've been brought by courtesy of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's also the one that has brought us peace by making Jews and Gentiles one in him. So before we gave our life to, before the salvation plan, before the Lord Jesus Christ came in his incarnation, the Jews were the people of God. Yeah, because God called Abraham out of the Gentile world and also made a covenant with him. And so we have the Jewish race. And of course, they were a shadow of the church. They are a shadow. They are the type of the church. We are the reality, we could say, going by what scripture say. Now, Christ is now with the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, he has now made the Jews and the Gentiles one new. So there's no Jew, there's no Gentile, no free, no bond, no male, no female. All are one in Christ. So we now have a new race of mankind. Allow me to use that expression, the race of Christ. So it's in this race of Christ, there's no fact that, oh, I'm an American, I'm from this part of the continent, I'm from South America, from Africa, from Europe, from wherever. Everyone is one in Christ. And that is the joy, courtesy of the blood of the Lord. So with his body, he broke down the middle wall of separation. So there's no longer a middle wall of separation. The veil was rent apart so that we can enter into the holiest of all. He abolished the Jewish law in order to create out of the two races one new people in union with himself. He had to do this, and because there was no way we Gentiles could come in to be one before the Lord. And of course, he had to do that by the substitutionary sacrifice on the cross of Calvary. So by his death, he has brought us back to God. He came and preached peace to us who were afar off. So he finished his work on the cross of Calvary, his earthly ministry, and he now came back to now preach that word. Because without him, of course, he's preaching through his vessels, through his disciples, through we is saying. And because without this word being spoken, I could almost say it's almost hard for anyone to give their life to the Lord. The word has to be spoken. Romans 10 says it, that the Lord is rich to all who call upon him. But how would they call upon him in whom they have not believed? How would they believe in whom they have not heard? And how would they hear except there be preachers? And how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel? So the word must be spoken. And of course, he now came back that, of course, till date, the word is still being spoken. This medium is a perfect opportunity as well. And there are different ministries out there doing wonderful things. The Lord is still speaking himself. I mean, not just confining himself to the four walls of a church. He's doing great and mighty things in the four walls of a church. And God is also going into the other platform, the social media. You talk about the marketplace, the government house, the Senate, everywhere. God wants everywhere to be saturated with his light. His word is the carrier of his life and his light. So for that light to shine, the word of God has to be spoken into the spirit, into the atmosphere. For through him, we now both have access by one spirit to the Father. That is the Jews and the Gentiles. We now have access by one spirit to the Father, the Spirit of the Lord. So you can see that it was through him we have access to the Father. There was no way. That's why I said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, that no one comes to the Father except by him. So we the one also still in towards the end of chapter 2, the one who has made us citizens of heaven, that we are made citizens of heaven and also members of the family of God. Could you imagine as a believer that you are a member of the family of God? It's sometimes, you know, in life, people sometimes will be imagining they were members of this particular family, or like the Rockefeller family, or this family that has wealth. But none of those family affiliation can ever be equal to be a member of the family of God. God has even said, if anyone takes care not of his household, is worse than an infidel and has denied the faith. Do you think God will not treat us as members of his family? If our active father know how to give good gift to their children, how much more our heavenly Father? So for you, for me, we are not just citizens on this earth here. We are not just members of a natural of our biological family. Thank God for it. But higher than that, greater than that, is that we are members of the family of God. What a joy. What a joy for what the Lord has done. What a joy. So the foundation of this app is also the foundation the apostles and the prophet build the saints on, because it's no other foundation can anyone lay except that which is laid in Christ Jesus. That's 1 Corinthians 3. And Paul was saying there that let everyone take heed how we built on it. It's also the cornerstone of the church. It's the cornerstone of the church. It's the pillar of the church. It's the foundation stone of the church. It's the capstone of the church. It's also a stumbling stone to the opposing Jews. Oh, and it's also a smiting stone to the unbelieving Gentiles. God, there's another teaching we did on Christ as the living stone. And we looked at those four, five different dimensions of him as a stone. It's a stone we build on. A stone is sturdy. You don't build on the sand. If you build on the sand, it's going to crumble, the scripture says. So what a joy that is the cornerstone. The cornerstones we learned are the pillars that hold the building together. That's the connection between the foundation and, you might want to call it, the actual building and the roof. Christ is the foundation stone. Christ is the cornerstone, is the pillar. It's also the capstone as well. It's everything about, it's also the life of the church. What a joy. So we can now go technically to, after this, I think this is the last one for chapter 2. We go to chapter 3. The one who holds the whole building together and makes it grow into a holy temple. There's still one more. Into a holy temple. Of course, the holy temple in the law. Still in the last point on chapter 2. The one in whom we are now, we are being built together for a dwelling place where God lives through his spirit. So God is now living through his spirit in the church. God is now tabernacling with us in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So God is living in the church, of course, by his spirit, which is we, the believers, the body of Christ. We are the body of Christ, that Christ is Christ is the tabernacle of God, is the temple of God. It is in him God is in, and it's because we are in him that now God can now live through us by his spirit. So let's go to chapter 3 as well. Chapter 3, it started with, when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. So as we read the scriptures and we pray to the Holy Spirit to open the eyes for understanding, we will understand the mystery of Christ. A mystery is a hidden information or a secret which is only certain privileged people have, only certain people are privileged to know of. And here is the Holy Spirit through Paul saying that as you read, as you study, God opens more of our eyes to the mystery of Christ. And also, what is this mystery? The mystery which was not made known in the other ages, but has now been revealed by his Spirit. It takes the Spirit of God to open up the scriptures, to open up the Bible for any one of us. There's no way we can know it without the Spirit of God. So he's the one that opens. It was hidden in ages past, and God has now unveiled it. The one true womb, we Gentiles are now partakers of the promise of God. That the mystery is that God is now bringing the Gentiles. God is now bringing those that were termed as, you want to call it, the dogs, Gentile dogs, those that were dead. God is now bringing them together with his people in the Old Testament, the Jews, as one people before the law. So as Gentiles, God has now made us partakers of the promise of God. What a joy. And still on chapter 3, the one we Gentiles are now members of his body. So God has not just redeemed us as slaves and made us his son, but God has now also made us members of the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. That means there's an organic union between us, former Gentiles, now saints of God, now members of the family of God. What a joy. The one whose unsearchable riches we pray. That's why Paul said that to him who is less than all the saints, that this commission was given to him to preach the unsearchable riches of Christ. That is, we are talking about the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, on what he has done, what he's doing, what he will continue to do. What a joy. There's no how people can, anyone would want to say no to the unsearchable riches of Christ. And we're not just talking about the physical and material blessings alone, but far beyond the material blessings, just the presence of God, just the joy of the Lord. What a joy, what a joy of what the Lord is doing in our life. Is the means through which God puts his secret plan into effect to achieve his eternal purpose. So is the very means through which God carries out his plan under the heavens. So anything God is going to do with man, redemption, sanctification, transformation, confirmation, glorification, every work that God will do, Christ is the very means to for God to attain his eternal purpose. God created all things by him. He's the one that, by the grace of God, the mercy of God, will do Christ in Genesis chapter 1. By the grace of God, the Lord will lead us by his mercy on that. You will see how Christ is actually, and the scriptures even tell us, Colossians 1 tells us that by him all things were created. So it's a joy to see the fact that he is the source of the creation of the heavens and the earth. In union with him, we now have boldness and access to God. Again, that phrase, in union with him. It's like a currency that we're going to use to purchase anything in the kingdom of God. We have no identity outside of our union with him. So our access to God, the blessings of God, the presence of God, the family or the membership of the family of God, the access to God, everything still goes back. Make us partakers of the body of Christ, is still union with him. And what a joy for what the Lord is doing. So by spirit, we are now strengthened in our inner man. So it is through his spirit. I love the prayer in that Ephesians 3 from verse 16-17, that we'll be strengthened with might by spirit in our inner man, that Christ will make his home in our heart, that we may be able to comprehend the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height of the love of God towards us in Christ Jesus, so that we might be filled with all the fullness of God. And now say to him, who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all we can ask or think, according to his power that works in us. So it is by his spirit we have been strengthened in our inner man. And our inner man is our real self. That is our true self. Every one of us, we have the outer man is probably the body. The inner man, which is our spirit being, that needs to be strengthened. That needs to be strengthened every day. And that's the bread of life that strengthens it. So the spirit strengthens it so that Christ will continue to make his home in our hearts. What a joy, what a joy. Also, the one whose love for us passes all knowledge. His love for us is beyond. They say greater love can anyone do than to lay his life down for his friends in John chapter 15. So there is no other greater love anyone can show than to lay down their life. And what a joy that he did that for us. That love passes all understanding. The one true womb, we are now filled with all the fullness of God, the divine glory, the divine mercy, the wisdom of God, all the attributes of God, the mercy of God. We can be filled with it only through that access of union with Christ. What a joy, what a joy. Also, the power within us through which God does more than we can ask or think. That is the very power in us which God uses to do more than anything we can ever ask or think. The joy is that there's a limit to what you and I can actually carry out in our human ability. He actually said in John 15 that without me you can do nothing. So it is the very power in us which God uses to, because it's the power of God, the power and the wisdom of God, and also the amen. So we go to chapter 4. It's also the one who gives us grace to walk worthy of our calling. It's the one that gives us, I could read from the beginning of chapter 4, that therefore that you walk worthy of the calling which you are called in Christ Jesus, in chapter 4 of Ephesians. And you want to say from chapter 1 to chapter 3, the effort. the Lord has done for us, more like an historical background. Now from chapter 4, now it's like the meat of where the epistle was going, about who we are in Christ and what God is intending to do in our life in the church. And it talks about the edification of the saint, about how much the Lord is also is cleansing us. In chapter 5, is nourishing us, is cherishing us. And chapter 6, that will be strong in the Lord. So it appears that there was a shift in from chapter 4 to the chapter 6. So chapter 4, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation which you are called, with all lowliness and meekness, and with long suffering, bearing with one another in love. So God is now saying, hey, look at everything I've done for you. Now I'm charging you that you walk worthy of the calling. That is, we walk worthy of what God has called everyone. God has not called you, it's not called me, he has not called anyone else to do everything. We are not omnipotent, it's not in our powers to do that. But there's a specific line, there's an area of life God has called each one of us for, and he's charging us that we walk worthy of that calling. The rule is I, you do you in the Lord, whatever God has called us. But we are members of the same body. So the hands, the function of the hands, the legs should not try to do that, as 1 Corinthians 12 tells us, everyone, let everyone abide where he's called. So there is one body and one spirit, even as you are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. And you can see that God is saying that we should rejoice in our oneness. There shouldn't be division. There shouldn't be, oh, maybe it's the eyes that has, is more important than the legs. We should not make such comparison, that there is one body, there's one spirit, there's one hope, there's one of your calling, one Lord. We don't have multiple Lords. One faith, one baptism. Also, one God and Father of all, who is above all, as the Father, in my opinion, and through all, and the Son, and in you all, and the Spirit. The great mystery of the Trinity, the divine Trinity. We're not going to go into that. We've had another teaching on that, but it's just the mystery of the Godhead. So here's God telling us that, look, we are all members of the same body, and we should do everything to bear with one another in love, that whatever we're doing should be the edification, which was now even said more as we go along. He said, the one who ascended up on high, Christ, and led captivity captive, and gave gifts to men. So he's now coming down to the area of the responsibility he has placed on us, that he led captivity captive. That is, he made a public spectacle, Colossians 3, public spectacle of principalities and power. And he did what? He led them captive and now gave gifts to men. So what a joy for the gift that he has given to us. Also, I think that was Colossians 2, 14, 15. So looking at also this, chapter 3, the one who descended to the lower part of the earth and then ascended far above all heavens, that he might fill all things with himself. So here's a picture of that. Before he is able, this is why the church fathers in the early 2nd and 3rd centuries came with the timely pneumatic Christ. That is the Christ as the Spirit, that before he could fill everywhere with himself, he came from heavens in his incarnation. He lived here as a human, as a mortal man. He died, resurrected. That is, he went to the lower part of the earth and now ascended to the heavens, that he might fill all things. So there is nowhere the Lord is not. Under heaven, there is nowhere is not today, because he's the same person who descended to the lower part of the earth and ascended up and filled all things with himself. So looking ahead as well, is the one who gave the fivefold ministry gifts to his church. And who are these gifts? The apostles, some apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, and for the edification of the body. So God, in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, have given us this fivefold ministry gift for the body of Christ to build up his saint. And let's see their job description. Let me put our job description. We could put it, because every one of us as believers in Christ Jesus, God has a calling for our life. And the goal of for every gift or ministry gift, God, I don't think there's any believer or any child of God that God has not given a gift to. God is saying the goal of that gift for you is to equip the saint for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of his body. It doesn't mean everybody will have a church or four walls and to say that, oh, this is they have a pulpit or so. everyone's pulpit might be different. The fishing rod God has given to every one of us could be different. Some have platform in the marketplace, like Joseph and Daniel. Their platform was in the political arena, Esther as well. So we all have our different platform, but God is saying that the goal should be for the equipping of the saint, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of his body. So everything we are doing, especially in the church, should point towards this direction. Any program we are doing in any sector, whether you're writing a drama script, whether a Sunday school outline, whatever it is God is saying, we should always ask ourselves the question. It doesn't mean that we might not do some social activities or function, but God is saying that let it be centered on, is it going to equip the saints? That means whatever program we're going to do, we should ask ourselves this question: how will the saints be equipped with this teaching? How will this help them to do the work of the ministry? Will this edify the body? And we pray that God will give us more grace to live up to that. He will work in us both to will and to do. So he now said, Stephen, that till we all come to the unity of the faith and to the knowledge of the Son of God. That is the curriculum for us as Christians. God's curriculum for the church, in my opinion, is that we come to the unity of faith and to the knowledge of the Son of God. He's the center focus for God for us. He's the one that we are centered on. That's how we are believers. Why are we believing in? It is in him. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. So here's God stating it out there, that till we all come to the unity of the faith and to the knowledge of the Son of God, and this knowledge is boundless. We can only go from one level to another, because the more of him we know, the more we discover we are even yet to know. As Paul said in Philippians 3, that I count all things but dung for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ. And so, because the more of Christ we know, the more of the fullness of God that will be manifesting in our life and our ministry. Still on chapter 4, it is the one whose stature and fullness all believers are to come to. So it's the very, very stature God is conforming us to. It's almost like when we were in high school, you have different subjects, and one of the subjects I struggled was fine art, whereby we are drawing, and because really even an exam on the test, they could just bring all the students out and tell you that, okay, look at that tree. The teacher would say, okay, that's your test. So everybody should start drawing. It's very hard, because that's the yardstick is going to use to evaluate every one of us, the student. So in the body of Christ, God is saying that we are to be conformed to the full stature of the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. As we behold him as in a glass, as in a mirror, we are being transformed from glory to glory. So the more we are beholding him, the more we are fellowshipping with him, the more we'll be conformed to his stature and to his fullness. Without this, we are just playing religion. If it is not Christ being formed in us as believers, if it is not Christ that is being magnified through our life, it's just another dead ritual. And we pray that the Lord himself will increase in our life. Still on chapter 4, the head we are to grow to. So is the head of the body, we are to grow into the head. I really don't know the anatomy of the human body. We could study it, but it's a lot of things I'm sure that are behind what you see physically of any human being. There are a lot of tissue, cells, connection, bones, and what have you. I mean, it's unbelievable. Even the fingers, it's easy to say this is 5 fingers, but if they could do an extra anatomy of what is inside there, it's just unbelievable. God is now saying that he is the head we are to grow into. From him, the whole body joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body. So it is how much of him that we are taking as the bread of life that determines the growth of the body. If he said it earlier on, that we all come to the unity of faith and to the knowledge of the Son of God. So he is the very head we are growing into. He's the very seed that our pastors and the fivefold ministry give, that they are planting everywhere. Because without the planting of this seed of Christ everywhere, the fruit of Christ cannot grow. So here's God saying that we are all coming to the headship of Christ. We are growing into him. Every joint, every part of the body, all of them should be working in unison, working with the central goal of having Christ exalted, Christ enthroned in every heart. And what a joy, what a joy. Still on chapter 4 as well, is the life of God, the very life of God himself. There is no this is the eternal life of God from chapter 4, mentioned that. I could read that part there when it said that put away stealing, so that some have been estranged from the life of God. I read from verse 17. This I say therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their mind, verse 18, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through their ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart. So you could see very much more that everything about the life of God is embedded in the Lord Jesus Christ. He's also the one true one. We are renewed in the spirit of our old and of our mind. I could read that 21:22, because it talks about putting off the old man. Verse 22 says that you should put off, concerning the former conversation, the old man, which is the old man in Adam, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and you put on the new man, which is after God is created in true righteousness, in righteousness and true holiness. So is the very one that is the one that we are being renewed in the spirit of our mind is of the old creation. Our spirit was reborn, but our mind still needs to be renewed. You know, we are a spirit, we have a soul, and we live in a body. So the mind, that's why I said that we have the mind of Christ, but that mind is filled with the worldly desires, the worldly cravings. Now God is saying that in this new creation, that mind needs to be renewed. How will the mind be renewed? The more the word of God is coming in there, the word of God displaces those old nature and breaks those evil or those Adamic will. Is the universal new man. The first man was Adam, the second man is the Lord Jesus Christ himself, is the true righteousness and holiness of God. What a joy for the person of the Lord. The word we ought to speak to impart grace to others. I probably need to read that as well. That's from verse 29. Let no corrupt communication come out of your mouth, but that which is good unto the edifying, and that which minister grace unto the hearers. It is the word of God. So God is saying that whatever we are speaking that will minister grace to the hearers, let it be that we are speaking the indwelling Christ to the life of the people, that they are born out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth will speak. So the more that he's making his home in our heart, when we are speaking, it's word of grace that we edify the saints, that we edify wherever we are speaking with. He said his word, their spirit and their life. So anytime we are speaking in the Lord, it is spirit and life that will minister life to the people. The one true womb, we are sealed with the Holy Spirit. We talked about that in chapter 1. It's also the one true womb God forgave us. What a joy that our forgiveness we enjoy is in him. Chapter 5 now goes on that is the one who loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling aroma. What a joy. We have another teaching on that, on the Christ as our offering to God. We've not really released that yet, but by the mercy of God, when that time comes, we would upload that. But it's just a joy to see that Christ is the fulfillment of all those sacrifices and all those offerings in the Old Testament. Every one of those offerings, it's all pointing, every one of them is pointing to Christ. The burnt offering, the meal offering, the peace offering, the sin offering, the trespass offering, the heave offering, every one of them was pointing to him. He's the acceptable one, because on the cross of Calvary, he became the reality and the replacement of all this offering. He's the light we are to walk in. I read from chapter 5 as well. He said that from verse 1. You therefore, followers of God as dear children, and walk in love as God also has loved and has given himself to us as an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savour. Verse 3, but fornication and all uncleanness, covetousness, let it not be named among you as becoming saints, neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. But for this you know that no warmonger, unclean person, nor covetous man who is an idolater had any inheritance in the kingdom of God, in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no man deceive you with vain words. For because you of these things commit the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them. Verse 8. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. Is the light in whom we are to walk on. And also, for this we know that no warm, which is what I just read, no warmonger, unclean person, or covetous man who is idolater has an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and in the kingdom of God. And also the fact that for we were sometimes darkness, but now we are light in the Lord. So what makes us light? We learn that the moon has no light of itself. What the moon just does is to position itself so that what we call moonlight is just a reflection of the sun to the moon, which is what gives light there. So we can just look at it as a picture of ourselves. We have no light in deceiving ourselves. We are only the light of the world because the Lord Himself, who is the light, is inside and residing inside of us. So we should walk as children of light, that in every area people should see the light of Christ through us. But all things that are exposed and made manifest by the light, for whatever makes manifest is light. And the glory, the joy is that wherever we go into, we should be a light that dispels darkness in every atmosphere. Therefore it says, awake you who sleep, arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. So he focused so much on the first part of Ephesians 5, on the light, on us being a light to the world out there. But we can't be light if we are spiritually asleep. I believe that he was talking about spiritual sleeping here, that he said, awake. Once we are awake from every spiritual slumber, Christ gives us light. And this light is not a one-time experience. I believe daily, as many times, because we need higher intensity of the light of God, the light of Christ, shining through our life to be a blessing to the world. I pray that by His Spirit, He will wake us away from every spiritual slumber. And do not be drunken with wine, which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns. So we see here in this picture, here in verse 5, in chapter 5, and from verse 16, 17, 18, talking about the fact that our thanksgiving and praise to God should always be in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, in the name of the Lord. Don't be drunken with wine, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns, in spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your hearts to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Giving thanks for all things to the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, in union with Christ. So there's no way, and there's no how we can be singing songs and making melody in our heart if our heart is not filled with what Christ has done for us. If we are ignorant of a lot of things, and let's not think that we know everything is done for us. I don't think I even have a percent of what he has done. Is far beyond what our minds. That's why it's called the unsearchable riches of Christ. But the joy of God is that he wants to keep unveiling, revealing most of the things he has done. His desire is to reveal everything to us, but do we have the capacity in our spirit, in our brain, to be able to comprehend? That's why our spirit man needs to be strengthened, so that we can be able to know the breadth, the height, the depth, and the length, and the height of the love of Christ for us. So giving thanks always for all things to God the Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. What a joy. He's the head of the church. So the second half of chapter 5 now goes about his relationship to the church. He's the head of the church, is the savior of his body. The church is his body, and is the head, of the supreme head of his church. The pastors are under him. They are stars in his hand, as Revelation chapter 1 makes us, and chapter 2 makes us to know that he's the very head. And headship here is not just like, when you have head of a team, head of a sport team, they use those terms, but really those are not really organic head. There's no life flowing from the head of it. A basketball team, for example, to the players. It's just, at the end of training or a game, everyone goes to their house. But the head of the church, there's an organic union. You can't separate the head from his body. So there's an organic union from the head and the body continually going on. He's also the savior of his body. I need to read that. I love to read that in chapter 5, when it talks about wives submitting yourself to one another in the fear of the Lord. Wives, submit to your wives, submit yourself to your own husband as unto the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and is also the savior of his body. There is nothing going on the body that the Lord is not aware of. So in prayer, we pray to him as well, that the Lord save. And saving doesn't mean it's not a one-time, it's a continual thing. Saving his body from any work of darkness. Also, he's the nourisher and cherisher of his body. He's nourishing, that is, he's feeding his body, his saints, with the bread of life, with the living bread, with the bread from heaven, through different medium. Your home church, whatever church of the living God, God has planted you, God is nourishing you. The Lord is nourishing you through the word of God. Of course, with your scriptures as well, with other different anointed teachings that are out there, God is nourishing you. To cherish, we learn that word is actually when mothers, especially nursing mothers, are looking after their little ones, how they sing to them just to make them happy. To make maybe encourage them to eat and to play and what have you. And it's a joy to see that the Lord is doing things to cherish his body, to make us happy, so that we can rejoice more in the Lord. What a love, what a joy of his body. He sanctifies and cleanses his church with his word. I'll read that from verse that's from verse 26. It says that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the word. Husband loves your wife even as Christ loved the church, for he gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having a spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but it should be holy and without blame, without blemish. So he's sanctifying and cleansing. So the more the word of God is speaking to us, and the more he's cleansing his church. John 15:3, he says that you are already clean by the word that's spoken to you. We are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bone. We are the bone of his bone and the flesh of his flesh. What Eve is to Adam in the person of the marital union is what we have to the Lord Jesus Christ. So we are bone of his bone and the flesh of his flesh. You can't separate the bone from the flesh or from the bones, and that you still have a living organism. That's what God has done for us in Christ Jesus. God has made us members of the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. What a joy. And chapter 6, the last chapter, talks about the standard of training and admonishing our children. It said, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and your mother, for this is the first commandment of promise, that it may be well with you and you may live long on the earth. It's also the real master we are working for. So that I'll probably still need to read that. The real master, that is like, we should not do any work we're doing, in even with our parents as well. Let's not think, even for us, even that are grown up, with those of us that say our parents, we should not just look at them as, okay, this is my parent, this is my master, this is my boss at work, this is my VP or my CEO. No, God is saying that do everything you are doing as if you are doing it unto the Lord. Whether in the marketplace, is the real master we all are working for. That's why I say, whatever you do in word or deed, do all unto the Lord. Is the rewarder of whatever good anyone will do. And it's also the impartial master in heaven. In that verse in chapter 6, I could read from verse 5. It said that, servant, be obedient to them that are your masters according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in singleness of your heart, as unto Christ, not with eye service as men pleasers, but as servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, with good will doing service as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that whatever good any man doeth, the same shall receive of the Lord, whether he be bond or free. And ye masters, do the same unto them, forbearing, threatening, knowing that your master who is in heaven neither is a respecter of persons with him. So, and in chapter 10, he now says, be strong in the Lord. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God. So there was going to be a spiritual warfare here. It's been said that Ephesians, what the book of Joshua is to the Jews, what the book of Ephesians is to us in the New Testament. God was preparing his children for battle to take over the promised land in the book of Joshua. That in the book of Ephesians, we can see what God is doing in chapter 6, that be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. That is, without being strengthened in the Lord, without a deep knowledge of the Lord, a growing knowledge of the Lord, there is no how we'll be strengthened with his might. He now said, put on the whole armor of God, so that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Christ is the very armor of God. It is the truth of all the seven armors that were given. Every one of them is pointing to him as the truth, whether it's the breastplate. So with the armor of God we are to put on, that enables us to stand against the wiles, not the power of the devil, the wiles, the tricks, the satanic seducement, the satanic the craftiness of the devil himself, that it's as we put on the armor of light that we are able to stand against it. So the armor goes on the truth. I am the way, the truth, and the life. They say, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. The truth is light. The breastplate of righteousness, Christ is the righteousness of God, is the truth himself. And if you see, all the armor is pointing to Christ, is the gospel of peace, is the good news, is the one that brings peace to earth, is the shield of faith. Is the author and the finisher of our faith. A shield is a protection. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are saved. So all the armor, they are pointing back to him. Is the word of God. In the beginning was the word was with God, and the word was God. Is the mystery of the gospel. What a joy. There's no mystery outside of him in the gospel, which is the gospel of good news. It's also the sword of the spirit. I'm not sure if we put that on. Classify that as the shield of faith. The sword of I think I was too fast in moving fast there. The gospel of peace, the shield of faith, the the shield of faith. Then we have the helmet of salvation. There's no other name under heaven by which man will be saved except through him. Is the helmet of salvation. Is the sword of the spirit. The words that are spoken unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Hebrews 4, the word of God is like a two-edged sword. So every of this armor is pointing back to him. They were all given allegories. I mean, the scriptures gave us allegory, but it's the reality. It's the mystery of the gospel. It's the word of God through which we are able to shine. And in ending, he now said, grace be with them all that love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Amen. So today we've been able to look at the book of Ephesians. Christ in the book of Ephesians, we looked at the part of what God did in eternity past and what God did for us, quickening us from chapter 1. Pretty much focuses on what God did for us in eternity past, and also how the church is the fullness of him that fills all in all. Chapter 2 went on to say that the church is the family of God, the kingdom of God, of what God in his rich mercy has done for us, seated us with Christ in heavenly places, how he has made Jews and Gentiles one before him, how we now have access to God by one spirit, and how God is dwelling in us by his spirit. Chapter 3 also talks about the mystery of Christ, about how the unsearchable riches of Christ is what we proclaim, how God has made us Gentiles to be partakers of his promise, and that grace prayer there, that we'll be strengthened with might by his spirit in our inner man, that Christ will make his home in our heart, so that we can comprehend the breadth, the length, the depth, the height of the love of Christ for us, which surpasses all human understanding, so that we might be filled with the fullness of God. And also chapter 4 says we should walk worthy of the calling God has called us, that there's one body, there's one spirit, there's one hope, there's one law of our calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, one Father of all, over, above all, through all, and in you all. And also how he has given the fivefold ministry gifts to the church, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and the teachers as well, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, and for the education of his body. And also how we are to be conformed to the full stature of Christ, and how we are to grow up into Christ as well. Chapter 5 now tells us how much light is needed as we walk as children of light, and also the marital relationship, the church as a wife of the Lord Jesus Christ, how Christ is the head of the church, the savior of his body, how he's cleansing his body, and how very much more he's nourishing and cherishing his body, and how we, the members of the Lord Jesus Christ, we are the bone of his bone and the flesh of his flesh. Chapter 6 tells us about the spiritual warfare, how we should be strong in the Lord, how we should put on the whole armor of God, and all those armor are pointing to the very person of the Lord Jesus Christ. What a joy of what Christ is to us. Hallelujah to the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.